grace be to save us.
O Lord, make haste to help us. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Alleluia! Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia! Alleluia! Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast, not with old leaven, neither with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Alleluia. Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death has no more dominion over him. For in that he died once unto sin, but in that he lives unto God. Likewise, reckon yourselves also to be dead unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Alleluia. Christ is risen from the dead, and become the first fruits of them that slept. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ shall all be made alive. Alleluia.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord my God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will see. At break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trample death, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the transfixed on Jesus' face. forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. O Lord our God. O Lord our God. O Lord, O Lord our God.
The Old Testament reading is from Isaiah chapter 53. Who has believed what he has heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm for today is Psalm 4. Please read it responsibly with me. Answer me when I call, O God of my righteousness.
You have given me relief when I was in distress. Be gracious to me and hear my prayer.
O men, how long shall my honor be turned into shame?
How long will you love vain words and seek after lies?
But know that the Lord has set apart the godly for himself.
The Lord hears when I call to him.
Be angry and do not sin.
Ponder in your own hearts on your beds and be silent.
Offer right sacrifices.
And put your trust in the Lord.
There are many who say, who will show us some good?
Lift up the light of your face upon us, O Lord.
You have put more joy in my heart
than they have when their grain and wine abound.
In peace I will both lie down and sleep.
For you alone, O Lord, make me dwell in safety.
The New Testament reading is from the book of Romans, chapter 3, verse 21 through 28. But now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Jesus Christ, whom God put forward as appropriation by his blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time, so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. When that becomes of our boasting, it is excluded. By what kind of law? By what law of works? No, but by law of faith. For we hold that one is justified by faith apart from works of the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Christ is risen from the dead, trampling down death by death, and upon those in the tombs bestowing life.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them,
"Peace be with you."
When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again,
"Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you."
And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them,
"Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld."
Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him,
We have seen the Lord.
But he said to them,
"Unless I see his hands with marks of the nails, and place my finger into the marks of the nails, and place my hand in his side, I will never believe."
8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said,
"Peace be with you."
Then he said to Thomas,
"Put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe."
Thomas answered him,
"My Lord and my God."
Jesus said to him,
"Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed."
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ. Christ is risen from the dead, trampling down death by death, and upon those in the tombs bestowing life.
Put your finger here and see my hand, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. In contemporary culture, we often forget about the possibility of conversion. We identify people by category: believer or non-believer, certain or skeptical, committed or nominal, religious or secular. And whatever category they are in, we assume, is the category in which they will stay. But in our reading today, we have the story of Thomas, the disciple who starts out by refusing to believe, but ends up making the most striking confession of faith in all of the Gospels. In other words, our Gospel passage is a story of conversion, where the secular becomes religious, where the nominal becomes committed, where the skeptical becomes certain, where the non-believer becomes the believer. So in this sermon, I'd like to explore what prompted Thomas's conversion. Let's consider the question under 3 points: peace, pistos, and piercing. Peace, pistos, and piercing. The first point is peace. It was the evening of Easter Sunday, and all the disciples were gathered together in a locked room. All of a sudden, Jesus appeared amongst them and said, "Peace be with you." Why did he say this? Well, he wanted to put the disciples at ease. They had good reason to be afraid. Their leader had just been crucified, and now rumors were spreading that his body had disappeared. The guards were saying that the disciples had stolen the body, and the disciples must have been wondering if they were the next to be arrested. And so they huddled together in a room, and they locked the door, seeking protection against a gathering storm of hostile forces. By saying, "Peace," Jesus assured the disciples that he came in peace, that he did not mean them any harm. Now, in the Gospel of John, we can't tell if the disciples recognized Jesus right away. But Luke says that when Jesus appeared, the disciples thought he was a ghost. In fact, as we saw last week in Jesus' appearance to Mary Magdalene, it was common for the resurrected Jesus to not be immediately recognized. There was just something different about his resurrected body. Now, I had a small taste of that this week when I finally had a haircut, one of the most precious services during this time of quarantine. Now, the next day, when I arrived home, my daughter, Madalena, ran up to greet me. But then she looked at me and she said, "This is not Dada." And perhaps the disciples were thinking the same thing. Is this really the Lord? Seems like he got a haircut or something more. He seems different somehow. But Jesus showed them his hands and his side and said again, "Peace be with you." And this second time, Jesus gave more explanation. "Receive the Holy Spirit," he said. "If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven." Jesus came not only to bring peace among men, but to establish a cosmic peace between mankind and God. He made this peace not through the might of a human army, but by shedding divine blood on the cross, that we might repent and be forgiven and receive the Holy Spirit. Every Sunday, we end our church service by sharing the peace of Christ. This is more than a friendly greeting. It is the same commission Jesus gave to his disciples to declare repentance and forgiveness to a sinful and a hurting world. One thing I love about this story is how true it is to life. Notice how excited the disciples were after this appearance of Jesus. They were energized and commissioned, and right away they shared this good news with Thomas, who had not been with them. And haven't we all had the experience of feeling moved during a Sunday gathering and being commissioned to go out and then sharing the gospel with a friend, only to find that he does not believe us? Well, that leads to our second point, pistos, peace and pistos. Pistos is the Greek word for belief. It is what Thomas says he will never have unless he touches the wounds of Jesus. Because of this story, the Apostle Thomas is often given the title Doubting Thomas. But if we look at the gospel text carefully, we will see that there is no reference in the story to doubt, which is a different Greek word. The words here are pistos, belief, and apistos, disbelief. These words are much stronger than doubt. Doubt is a kind of uncertainty, an inability to settle on a conclusion, and it is an experience that often accompanies the life of faith. Disbelief, however, apistos, is a refusal to believe. It is a rejection of what one has heard. Jesus uses the same word to describe a faithless generation, and Paul uses it to describe persistent unbelievers. Thomas is not so much doubting as he is apostate. Let us not forget what we read in Romans chapter 3, that in Christianity, the righteousness of God is available not to those who live the best lives, nor to those who are most religious. Rather, the righteousness of God is available by faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. Now, Jesus had no need to appear to Thomas. And even if he did appear, he was under no obligation to show Thomas his wounds. But out of his grace and mercy, Jesus did appear once again. And even though Thomas was stuck in disbelief, Jesus, by his grace, decided to make himself known. And this leads to our third point, piercing. Peace, pistos, and piercing. The next Sunday, Thomas was with the disciples. He didn't believe yet, but he was at least curious enough to join them. Jesus arrived again. Again, Jesus greeted the disciples with a word of peace, and then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." Stephen Procopio has created a remarkable illustration of this scene. It is a drawing of Jesus's hand. Only the hand is not a hand of normal, perishable flesh. It is a hand of resurrected life, of plants and flowers, symbolizing the new creation we have in Jesus. But this resurrected hand still bears the piercing, the scar, the mark of the nail of the cross. And in this piercing, Stephen has depicted the face of Thomas, his eyes partially obscured, partially looking out in wonder. Jesus has allowed Thomas to touch and see, and Thomas is beginning to believe. Thomas is having his conversion, and his response is electric. "My Lord and my God." This confession of faith is the most dramatic and most complete statement of faith in the Gospels. And they came from the apostate Thomas, who in the prior week had refused to believe. So what prompted Thomas's conversion? I think it was a series of events culminating with a powerful realization. It started when Thomas wasn't even with the disciples. He was probably scared, perhaps in hiding, and he must have felt convicted, ashamed to have left Jesus and his friends in their time of need. But the disciples who gathered on Easter Sunday did not abandon Thomas. During the week, they went out and they found Thomas, and they told him the good news of Jesus. They shared with him the gospel. And though he said that he would not believe, Thomas was curious enough to join them for their next Sunday gathering. And then, shockingly, Jesus gave Thomas exactly what he asked for. He revealed himself. And what Jesus showed Thomas was the most surprising thing of all. Jesus showed Thomas a resurrected body with piercings from the cross. You see, a resurrected body is a new body, an imperishable body, one that will never suffer or die. It is the perfect body that God meant it to be. How amazing that the resurrected body of Jesus is still pierced. That can only mean one thing. It must mean
that Jesus' piercings were part of God's perfect plan. It must mean that sacrificial love is the very nature of God. It means that God loves you and me long before we ever love him. And he takes on himself our suffering and death, and he gives to us his life. Who has believed what he has heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And by his wounds, we are healed. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Alleluia.
Apostles met in fear. Amidst them came their Lord most dear, and said, "My peace be on all here." Alleluia.
Alleluia.
Let us pray in the words that our Lord Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Now join us in our concluding prayer. Almighty God, who through your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, overcame death and opened to us the gate of everlasting life, grant that we, who celebrate with joy the day of the Lord's resurrection, may be raised from the death of sin by your life-giving Spirit, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with your spirit.
As the Father sent our Lord Jesus Christ, even so he has sent us, to receive the Holy Spirit, and in the Spirit to preach to the conviction and forgiveness of sins. And now the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Please share with one another a sign of Christ's peace.
Open our eyes, Lord. We want to see Jesus, to reach out and touch.
Say that.